Introduction to graph databases. So, about me, some words, because, yeah, I should introduce myself. I'm a chief software architect in IT Imagination. It's a big Polish IT company. There we are building one of the biggest .NET projects in Poland. 45 developers and almost 200 people involved. Besides that, I'm interested in digging into data and distributed systems. And after work, I do this. It's a contextual search engine for recipes, and I will talk a bit more about it later. Okay, long, long time ago, in a far, far land away, there lived a king. Yeah, so you actually don't start with a legend in most presentations, but actually in this case, yeah. In 1736, in Kaliningrad, this is in current Russia, basically a king had a river, and this river had many bridges, as actually you do, and he actually he said that he will give a quite big reward for someone who will say, if you can cross all the bridges only once and cross all of them. Then a shiny knight on a huge horse came, called Leonard Euler, and basically draw this and created our first graph. And this is basically a legend how graph databases came, graphs in math came to being. And he basically said that no, you can't actually do it, because the number of edges going in and out from each node is not divisible by two. And long, long time after it, basically we had the definition of a graph. Graph is a pair of all nodes and edges connecting those nodes. Yeah, so basically this is the map definition and the legend definition, but let's see actually what is a graph. This is a graph. It's a very lonely graph. If it's lonely, let's give him a friend. We have another node and we added an edge. As simple as this way of thinking is, it's actually you can actually model some systems like Facebook with it. Now let's look at another social network like Twitter. Basically, what we've done is given a direction to this graph. It's called a directional graph. And actually, what this allows us to do is basically I am observing you, but you don't actually have to know about me. Let's go deeper. And the case where most people think about graphs is this. So we are adding a value to the node, value to the label, and actually what you can use it for modeling is actually for cities. You have one city, another, and a road connecting it. The roads in most cases are directional. So yeah, now let's go funky. Let's build a graph that allows for two nodes to have multiple edges of the same type between them. And as funky it is, it actually doesn't have that much of implementation in the real world. It's a graph that it's kind of used in math. Let's get down to earth. Let's build a graph that's called a label graph. What we actually done is basically we allowed for we allowed for any edge and any node to have a label. Simple, simple. It is quite okay, but this is way better. It's called the property graph, and it allows for each node, edge and node, to have a label and data connected to it. Now I have a question. Does this remind anyone of anything? No hands up. This one? Nope. This one? Yeah? About what? Yes, exactly. Thank you very much. So there's a guy in funky trousers saying you about graph databases, but graphs are about relations, and we have relational databases. So what's up? Doesn't make any sense. Well, actually, it does, because graph databases are quite the opposite of relational databases. And to understand why, let's look at some history. Let's first see when the relational model actually came to being. It came to being in 1970 with Mr. Codd. Mr. Codd basically wrote a few page paper called relational model, in which he described how he imagines data should be stored and how we should look at data. But to understand why it actually gained enough traction that we are building thousands of systems with relational database, let's look what else happened in the 1970s. First, the RAM got a lot cheaper, because in 2 years we went through more than $2,500 to only 734 megabytes. For the young ones in the audience, and there are some, yeah, 1,000 megabytes is 1 gigabyte. Let's go further. IBM created this. And if you are thinking about a dishwasher, you are quite right, because it is the size of a dishwasher. It's a 100 megabyte disk, and it has also one similar thing to a dishwasher: the access time and the speed. In the specs, it could transfer 1,0043 megabytes a second. So they were quite specific. Let's go further. Intel releases its almost 800 kilohertz 8-bit processor. And again, for the young ones, kilohertz, 1,000 kilohertz is 1 megahertz. And you may not know this unit, but I will explain it later. Next, 3 years later, we actually bumped the speed only a bit, but we went from 8-bit to 16-bit. So this allowed us to access a lot more memory, because our data is growing quite rapidly. Next, Oracle and Apple I. So Oracle, the first commercial implementation of a relational database, and the first in white computers. Next, we have the granddaddy of all chips that are in almost any PC, so Intel 8086. And we went to almost, to almost 10 megahertz. Again, so as you can see, in 7 years we went from 800 kilohertz to 10 megahertz, so almost 15 times improvement. That's a lot. Yeah. So let's contrast it with how graph databases came to being. As we said, 1936, the graph, the bridge problem. Next, the map coloring problem. Basically, a problem that how many colors do you need to color any political map? And this problem is quite interesting, because it interlines quite funny with the history of computing. Next, if we are talking about math, so we should have a book about math. So we have a book few years later. Next, the graph problem is map coloring problem is partly solved. Why partly? Because there is a proof. But in the proof, the mathematicians say that, yeah, we prove it in, yeah, prove that you can color using 4 colors, but there is about 40,000 maps that we should check manually. And because we didn't have enough crayons, we had to wait 30 years for the problem to be solved. It actually took a few days for the computer to calculate, and we had a proof. Next, Pentium 4. And why I'm talking about it? Because Pentium 4 is the highest value that we were able to go on one core. Another question to the audience: does anyone remember which module of the modern computer started to evolve quite rapidly thanks to Pentium 4? This is the cooler of Pentium 3. This is the cooler of Pentium 4. Someone thought, let's put a jet engine. Yeah, Pentium 4 had a huge heating problems, enough so that Intel basically scraped this idea, took Pentium 3, put 2 chips in 1 chip, and basically we have Core Duo and the multi-thread revolution. Okay, so I told the history of one and another, and there are 2 things we should note. Those databases were designed and evolved in completely different environments. One, when the power of computing on one chip was growing quite rapidly, and the other, when we already said that we can't go actually quite further, because 1 year later we had the first commercial graph databases. The other thing, if you think about relational databases, the thing that pops into mind is the relational model. So basically deconstructing your data and putting it in separate tables and so on and so on. But actually, why are we doing it? There's a simple answer. Because if we denormalize the data, it takes up less space. If we have in a column a string or a datum, and we extract it, put it in a separate column, and only use a shortened to index it, we are actually using less storage space for this data. Now, 1 gigabyte is really cheap. OK, let's go and see how the current ecosystem of graph databases looks like. And this is only a subset, really. There are two lines. Processing, basically, the more graph way of processing, and storage. And about storage, I will tell some later. Here we have a flock. Flock is commonly called the graph database of the pool, because what it could do is basically it could only get you the child nodes connected with the parent, nothing more. So someone may ask, and he would be right, why would someone design a database like this? The answer is quite obvious when you think who actually designed it. Twitter. Why? Because if you tweet something, what Twitter does is basically gets the people who are following you and puts that tweet in their timetable. That's all. It didn't have to do anything else. This quite good shows that graph databases in most cases are designed to solve one specific problem. And they do it very good. They are not a general purpose databases. Next, next the upper part, we have infinite graph. This is a graph that basically the computing engine behind the graph is stored locally, and the storage is geo-redundant. We have Microsoft Trinity. It is also a very interesting graph database. Basically, what Microsoft thought is like, let's design a graph database that would be able to run the cloud and could process terabytes of data. So what they've done actually is that each node and actually the queries you run are run by messages. And what this database does is basically route these messages to nodes containing the data. The idea is quite interesting because it obviously should was designed to run on Azure. And if anyone likes, it was open sourced, I think, five days ago. So we can have a look. Titan, which currently was replaced by Julius, it's a database that you can swap the storage engines. It supported Hadoop, and basically Cassandra. Now Julius supports also Elastic, and I think some relational databases. Next, the lower part. Yeah, basically those two databases are designed to store knowledge. This also a part of computing and IT that graph databases are quite good at. And we'll talk about it more later. Next, the upper part. So yeah, the graphs that store data in a native way and process in a native way. We have OrientDB, and it's quite interesting beast because it's a relational database, key value database, and a graph database in one. And you can ask questions to it using SQL, so quite interesting. Next, affinity index. One is designed to handle IoT, and the other is designed to run on your phones. Basically, Android and iOS supported, so yeah. Next, Neo4j, and the most general purpose database of all of them here, and we'll be talking about more about usage. Amazon, or basically any other shop. In any shop you go into, you have a category or a panel showing you the similar products. But basically, similarity is tricky. What is similarity? Similar title, similar text, similar price, what? Basically, what's a really better idea to think about similarity is this. Let's have one person. He enters our shop here, clicks around, and buys something. Let's take another person. Enters, clicks, buys something. And another one. Enter, clicks, buys something. If you look at the problem in a graph way, you will actually see the nodes that are the most interesting. So if anyone goes into the upper node, this one, you should actually be showing him in a similar this book, because most people that saw this product actually bought this one. So this isn't a similarity in products, but it's a similarity of how people are thinking about those products. Quite better. If you have 10 customers a day, it may not work. If you have millions of them, it's a good way. Next. A bit different thing, but not that much. Basically, what do you do if you have, let's say, £1 million? You can buy a Porsche or a Aston Martin house and so on and so on. But in a soon time, the IRS will come and ask you one simple question. Could you actually show us where did you get the money for it? And then the story goes, you basically go to jail. So how do you actually, if you have $1 million of pounds, how do you actually make this money legal? It's quite simple, but basically, don't take my word for it. Google it yourself, but yeah. You basically get a group of people. They go buy some, they go to a hairdresser, spa, saloon, and so on and so on. They spend this money. Then those places spend the money in another place. The longer the chain you actually do, it is harder to track. And finally, this money, of course, after taxing, goes back into your pocket. So how do we actually fight with those people? Actually, we input each transaction, the from, to, and the amount. The amount is just for keeping data. And if we input enough of them, we actually start to see some patterns. And this is quite powerful, because using this technique, you can actually do this. This is Iceland. And this is not a national picture of all Icelandic people, but you can actually say it is, because this is what happened when people from Panama Papers, the scam, used this technique. Basically, they inputted each invoice, each paper, and they actually found a trail that proved that their Iceland Prime Minister had an offshore account. Yeah, so graphs are powerful. It was not because of one single paper. It was because of a series of paper and a connection of relations. Yeah, let's go further. NLP. And if someone is doing NLP, this is a simplification. But yeah, it proves some point and shows one thing I would like to show. We have this question. Sushi restaurants in New York that my friends like. It's a simple question. We basically can write a simple program that will understand each word. But actually, understanding the question or giving the answer is way more complicated. But it's actually not. Let's see. We have location, New York. That's simple, basically. We have a dictionary that has all the cities. We can actually say that the location is New York. We have cuisine type, sushi. This is quite simple also. We have, well, that's not me because I don't have that many friends, but basically a stock guy that has some friends. Yeah. So basically we have this part, we have this part, and we have this part. So what will be the answer to our question? It will be the nodes that will fill our graph, that nodes that have the connection to all three of them. Simple. It gets even more fun when we look at this. If we would say that this was implemented by, for example, Facebook, we are looking at billions or hundreds of billions of nodes. But in this parsing of this question, we, in neither of case, we didn't actually scan all those nodes. We took one city, one cuisine type, we took one person and their friends. So our dataset is built from billions of nodes, but actually in each step, we are talking about a single node or couple of hundreds of nodes. This is actually where graph databases show their power. If you ask the right question and ask the question in the right way, you can actually compute on huge datasets and do it really, really fast. Okay, this is the case of New York Times, in the case of an apple. And does anyone know what an apple is? Come on, you should know what an apple is. One guy put his hand up, and he is wrong, because apple is, of course, sorry for that. Apple is, of course, a fruit. And what can the New York Times know about the apples? Of course, the companies selling it, the economical stats, the types of apples, nutritions. Apple is, of course, Apple Inc. So we have Tim Cook, the iPhone, the lack of the touch bar in the new MacBook. Apple is, of course, there are, two films, Apple. Apple is, of course, Apple is the name of one Star Trek episode, because there's a Star Trek episode for anything. There's, of course, Apple Records, which are the Beatles. And the Beatles, this is connected quite strongly to this, because they had a dispute over the name. Next, you have a Russian party nicknamed Apple. And we actually, when you go to the Wikipedia, you actually have 17 meanings of the word apple. That's a lot. And basically, what graph databases allow you to do, it's input all of those types. And depending from the type of data you are interested in, you only look at the subset. Because they are nodes. So you are ignoring some nodes, and you are looking at another. If you would add another type of an apple, you're just adding knowledge. The schema is the effect of this knowledge, basically. And you actually don't have to work in the New York Times, basically because Google has the graph knowledge program. And it's quite powerful, because this, of course, Leonard Euler, born, died, yeah, the obvious data, influenced. You wouldn't put a field called influenced if you would implement it using a relational or a object database, because it's not that common. But we can go even further. We have Spock. And Spock has a species. The species is of course, Vulcan. Using a graph database, this isn't changing the schema. It's only adding knowledge. And the knowledge of the database reflects the schema. And it's the obvious way to go. You're adding knowledge, and the database expands what it knows. Well, performance, yeah. Did anyone try to model a hierarchical structure using a relational database? Yeah, again, you, yeah. You did it wrong, but I will say why. Basically, what we actually do, but I also done it, to be fair. If you have a, let's say you are modeling a structure of people, basically children and parents. So we have a table of persons and a table of children and parents. So we take one person, get the children. Then you have 2, 3, 4 children. And again, you are scanning this huge index because the child-parent table will be quite long. And you are looking for the next children. And again, and again, and again. Basically, in each step, you are scanning a really huge index. It can be fast, but doing it multiple times won't. And how do graph databases do it? This is the part when we distinguish between storing data in a relational model and in a graph model. In a graph model, you actually have the IDs in the node. So you don't have to do all the jumps, all the scanning of indexes, and so on, so on. You get a node, you have the parents, you have the children. That's all. Another task, traversing. So basically going from node A to node B. So we'll try to find a path from here to here. So what we do is, of course, get the children. Next, we have subgraphs. And because we are looking for the shortest path, those subgraphs are or can be independent, and we can actually search them independently. They can be run in another process, thread, or on a machine. Because even if this node, this subgraph, had, let's say, millions of nodes, if we are looking for the shortest path, we'll only return a couple of hundred paths. That's all, because the rest will be the inner nodes. Next, what we do, we return it and basically connect it and map it on a single machine. This is how MapReduce basically works. Compute the data where it actually is stored. Don't and transfer only the necessary part. Yeah. But that was the theory. Now let's look at an experiment. Experiment was done in 2012, I think. Basically, I think Berkeley has a site where you can have data. You have data from all kinds of social networks, from Foursquare to MySpace to Twitter and so on. They scrub the services, anonymize the data, and you have datasets of 100 gigabytes and so on, so on, so on. What they actually did is basically took Twitter, which had over 1.5 billion watches, almost 50,000 users, and they assumed Twitter had those statistics. What they've done is this. They bought 40 cheapest machines in Amazon. Each of the machine had a shared CPU and I think 2 gigabytes of data, 2 gigabytes of RAM and so something like this. And basically they bought 6 most powerful machines. And what they created is, here you use Titan in a cluster and here you use Cassandra as a storage engine. Why? Quite obvious. Because then, because they bought really cheap machines, they actually, when you sum it, they actually had a lot of RAM. So they were able to process data in here, in the upper part, and basically use only this part for persistence. And basically what Cassandra is also good is that if they wrote the data to one node, it could share the data on all nodes. So this is what they done, and this is the stats. Account creation, tweeting, reading, recommendations. And this is the numbers. This is numbers. Quite nice, I would say. The longest is account creation, 100 milliseconds. The recommendation part is 67 milliseconds. In the they run it for about a bit more than 2 hours. And the average day average 6,000 transactions. In the peak, 10,000 transactions. But this is not the fun part. It cost them $11. This is the fun part. It's cheap, yeah. And of course, they had high availability, redundancy from the design. Because, 40 nodes, so if one goes down, doesn't make a difference. Next, Neo4j. Basically, why Neo4j? Because there is a site called DB Engines. And on this site, basically, Neo4j is the most popular graph database, and it fluctuates from 20 to 21 most popular databases there is. It has drivers for almost anything, for almost any language. And Cypher now is basically they created something called Open Cypher, that is a standardized query language for graph queries. And of course, there is a free version. And a paid version. The paid version has support for online backups and so on, so on, so on. Okay, now my problem. This is Cookit. What basically Cookit does is basically it has a couple of crawlers. They crawl the web and basically are looking for cooking recipes. If they find the recipes, they extract the text. From this text, they extract the ingredients, amounts, units, and so on, so on. So a lot of metadata. What you actually see here is the graph of all the ingredients. It has about 3,000 ingredients. It has about 3,300 edges. And because it's a tree, so basically there are 9 master nodes, it goes so, and I don't have cycles, so it goes up to 9 level deep. So from the root node up to 9 levels. Yeah. So basically, because I'm doing it using a program, I wanted to check my data. And I was thinking about, let's check if it doesn't do anything stupid. And I found this question. Let's check if I have some recipes that have ingredients containing fish and sweet drinks, like Coca-Cola, Fanta, and so on, so on. You actually don't find those two ingredients with each other, almost. So, I use Cypher. What I've done is using this. This is a match. Match says something like this. Look out, I will write a pattern for you to look for. Basically, in Cypher, think of it like a child of really strange love between ASCII art and SQL. So it's strange, but you really get used to it because it's quite nice. Next, basically, anything that you input in the round parentheses, it will always be a node. This tells me that this node is of type of a recipe, and this is the name of the node. So I can basically use it later. Next, let's do the same with an ingredient. Again, definition of a node, name, and type. Next, we should say that those two are connected. Simple. This shows me that it's a relation, and this shows me the direction of this relation. And this shows me the label. Actually, in the Neo4j, you can have this shows me the type. Nodes can have multiple labels, and edges can have only one type. Okay, so now we have recipes and their direct ingredients. But we should go from this one ingredient up to the top to check if its root is fish or sweet drinks. Let's do it. And we should also return those two. So what I've done is use this and, so this ingredient, and set from this ingredient that the recipe has, traverse up to nine levels up. This is saying up to nine levels. Edges with type from and specification until you find the node of type ingredient that will have in the data fields name, sweet drinks. And let's do the same with fish. And as I learned a bit few minutes later, I should also put a limit on it. Yeah, and that's all. Doing it using SQL will take me about 50 lines, and I will have to use a recurrent query, and their syntax is quite strange. And this is all, basically. And it runs about 5 to 6 times faster than SQL Server. And one thing more, I'm quite better in optimizing SQL than Neo4j, so you can actually probably run it faster than I did. Okay. One thing to sum up, because summing is important, basically when to use graph databases. When you the obvious case is when you have relational and hierarchical data. Next, there's a saying in people who play with graph databases that if your relations are more important than your data, or if your relations are your data, then you should use a graph database, because then you can basically ask questions about patterns, ask questions questions like, is there any connection between nodes of this type? You don't have to know the exact types of the nodes, and so on. Next, to visualize data. There are a lot of tools that help you visualize really large data sets, and they basically plug into most graph databases. Also, what knowledge databases do, getting sense of the data. So basically inputting all your data and seeing how it looks, is it clustered, and getting the feel of it. Next, when not to use graph databases. Because one very, very important thing, those are not general purpose database. If you will try to use them in a not so good case, you will really get bitten, and very strongly. Basically, for data manipulation heavy systems, if you want to have large text fields in the nodes, if you want to store binary data, you can actually do it, but you should. The proper way to do it is basically have this huge data sets in a relational object database, and in a graph only having the IDs, only having the data connected with the relations. The data that you need for proper search queries. Next, if we are talking about huge datasets like petabytes, terabytes, and hundreds of gigabytes, don't count on AC transactionality. Most of those databases have AC transactionality, but when you are talking about distributed databases like Titan or Julius, that's not the best case. And the most important one, because I really wouldn't like to hear in a few months that somebody replaced their relational database with a graph database. They are not a replacement for relational databases, and never were designed and never should be used. They can be used besides, and they work in this version really good, but don't replace one with another. And that's all. Any questions? 40 minutes. Tum, 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 tum.
Oh, can I just pass you the mic? Sorry.
I was going to say, what was the recipe with fish and soft drinks?
There were a lot of mistakes, because in Polish, because I'm parsing the languages in Polish, salt and one fish have basically the same writing. And another thing is that basically you have cocktails with shrimp and soft drinks, and they also came in this query. Yeah, so really strange things can be found.
Would you mind passing it? Thank you.
I suppose, say you've got like a data set like Facebook's or Google's where it's going to be huge, loads of data.
Yeah.
Do you know anything about how you would split up that database across different servers? Because I imagine you're not going to have it all on one machine. It's going
to
be...
You don't want to have... There comes the tricky part, because if you have something called the super node, it's a node that has way more connections than any other node. Let's take me on Twitter and Barack Obama. He will have way more people observing him than me. Then it gets tricky, basically. But what you actually can do is store this data in a cluster. And the cluster should manage sending the data between the nodes. But basically, what I would do, if it was a reporting database, I would use Hadoop or any other distributed system, and basically only have a graph API above it. So basically, process the data using distributed systems.
OK, thank you. Pass it on down.
I just thought it was interesting what you said about not mastering, but using both relational and graph database. What's the general pattern for that? Is it that you update in the relational database and then that cascades afterwards? No, it's...
No. The key when doing something like this, basically when doing multi-database storage, is if you can have a situation that one database is the single point of truth for some subset of data, then you are able to basically just insert in this database and migrate to the rest. If the second database doesn't write to this data, you won't have conflicts. If you will have conflicts, it's not a best idea. But if you have a single point of truth, it's very easy to do. And I'm similar thing when, for example, using Solr or Elasticsearch. Basically, those are indexes that you can basically scrap and fill it from zero to top. They don't have data, so basically, yeah. Any other questions?
How do people generally expose the data from a graph database? Do you wrap it in some other sort of API, or how does that work?
It depends. As the most popular answer in IT, it depends, because in many cases you are exposing it using visualizing engine, basically. So those engines have the ability to ask questions using Cypher, and basically they are drawing you hundreds of nodes in answers. This is basically how the guys from Panama Papers done it. They used Neo4j for storing transactional data, for storing the knowledge of these graphs, but basically to get a glimpse of how this data looks, they actually used I don't remember the name of the product, but the product allows you to only display the data. You can't manipulate the data this way. Of course, another usage is basically having an API that will say you if the path exists and so on. In fraud detection, you will use something like this. If, for example, the transaction looks fraudy or is connected to some credit card that was blocked in some way, and yeah. So many cases, mostly splitting visualization and asking simple questions. Any other? Okay, thanks.